Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all to Seoul University, Korea once again. I know it's ninth, the JSEP meeting already. As Taniguchi Sensei and Suzuki Kaijo mentioned, it is with deep sorrow that we open the ceremony this morning. she was a very good lady, very active in her field of study, which is speech pathology and voice study, human voice study. And she's done so much in that field, you know. She's sort of upgraded the level of studies of that field in Korea. And as you know, she also done something quite useful for EPSJ, attending conferences in Japan for the past 5-6 years, giving good papers. Thus expanding, widening the scope of EPSJ academic research. She was like, we were like brother and sister, especially personally speaking, and she respected me, he liked me so much, and she was still a young lady of 45, the same age as Dr. Hyun Lee. You know, long way to go. And I'm sure you'll agree with me that her death is a great loss to the field of speech pathology and voice study in Korea. She spent a year last year in China, again doing a lot of things, contributing, greatly to the study of speech pathology in China, and arranged a number of international conferences there. She was the key figure, the organizing committee chairman of the forthcoming the International Voice Congress, which is to be held in Korea. And I don't know what to say about that. Okay, so much for Dr. Okuranjong, as you say, Japanese colleagues, Okuranjong. The real Korean name is Ongnanjong. Ongnan and Okuran. the difference in pronunciation always makes me smile, you know, so interesting. This is a brand new building, it's just, finished. And it's next to the number three building, where I used to stay in my, office for the past 33 years. Now handed down to Dr. Hyun Lee, the same room. And this is the place where I used to give my lectures for the, special lectures for big audience. Okay, I do welcome you once again, and hope we'll have a wonderful and fruitful presentation and discussion today until the 4:30, is it, in the afternoon. Thank you very much. Let me show you one or two pictures of the late Okuranjong. This was taken in Miyazaki, December last year. And this one's at a hotel of Miyazaki, just before departing for the Kaigijo. She was very ill, in fact, and she had about 4 to 5 international conferences to attend from September last year until December. She cancelled the other conferences and just attended the CPSJ in Miyazaki, because she had special affection for EPSJ, especially she admired the way Suzuki Gaicho, you know, conducted, managed EPSJ, and also she adored the close relationship between Suzuki Gaicho and me. That's why she, couldn't cancel this Miyazaki conference last year. I'd like to play a little song for you, a song which this is a song I've been fond of for the past nearly 40 years. And also, this is the song very much liked by Dr. Chong Ognan, Ognan Chong, whenever I sang it. This is a Scottish song called Believe Me, If All Those Endearing Charms, etc. It's a very long title. Let me try and play it for you. It. I hope you liked it, and move on to the main part of my presentation. The title is Japanese Speakers' Perception of Syllable Final Consonants. Japanese speakers have been known to experience difficulty perceiving syllable final consonants, and therefore find it difficult to correctly perceive and pronounce the final consonants in languages such as Korean and English. Let me quote some examples. The name Okranjeong, you know all this name, which in Korean is Ongnan, and Japanese colleagues usually call her Okuran, Okuran, Okuranjeong. And there's a problem of, you know, the syllabification involved. this is a very difficult sequence in Korean, this ok ran, you know, and through various assimilation procedure, it becomes ong nan. Kimchi, you know, old kimchi, it's pronounced by Japanese kimuchi, with vowel u inserted. Pap, boiled rice, gohan desu ne. It's pronounced pabu, mainly pabu. Kaktugi, this is daikon de tsukutta mon desho, Korean side dish. Korea, if you go to Japanese, you know, the Korean restaurant in Japan, Tokyo, and many places in Japan, if you pick up the menu, there's, you know, the いろいろ料理が出てきますけど、これは学的と表現されましたね。It's transcribed in, of course, Japanese katakana, 学的 instead of 学的。この KT sequence is very difficult for you Japanese colleagues. Kukpa.Soup rice, it's a kind of soup with rice in it, is usually transcribed and pronounced kuppa. The final bilabial sounds completely deleted. And the name of your country, Ilbon, is in the Korean word Ilbon, and it's usually pronounced by Japanese as Ilbon, Ilbon. So this two-syllable word, Ilbon, in Korean, is turned into what? How many syllables? Ilbon, four syllables. Now, this kind of, you know, the factor plays a very big role in pronouncing and learning and pronouncing foreign languages like Korean and English, etc. So this paper attempts to assess objectively the difficulty experienced by Japanese speakers in perceiving the syllable final consonants, syllable final as in pap, and intervocalic consonant clusters in Korean words as in kuk, pap, kp, kb. Three sets of pre-recorded Korean words were played to the Japanese speakers, were told to write down the words that they've heard using Roman letters or Japanese kana letters or phonetic symbols if they could. Each word was played twice for the informants with a short intervening pause. The test was carried out on the same day for the same informants to see if there's any difference between the first and second session. These are test material, word list. A, B, C, three sets. AB consists of, these are monosyllable words, all ending in a voiceless plosive sound like katupu. So this is ka, pak, pat, pap, and pap, pit, pip. This was the way I pronounced this, you see, and recorded. And B, pap, pat, pak, is a PTK. And pit, pip, pik, TPK again. And the C group consists of two-syllable words, as in pakka, KK, patka, TK, and pakka, PK, PT, patpatta, pakpa, KP, and KT, patta. They all occur in ordinary Korean, you know, speech. They were written in Roman letters with Hangul letters given in brackets. I've already explained. PH in the list stands for aspirated, heavily aspirated plosives. Rather difficult for Japanese to pronounce heavily aspirated, because Japanese voiceless plosive sound has less aspiration than Korean. And the final PTK in section A and B represent unexploded plosives or implosives. Okay. Recording. Well, I'll skip this. Recording is not very important here. Informants for the perception test. The informants for the perception test were all Japanese who were either born in Tokyo or lived in Tokyo for more than 10 years and received higher education. Of seven informants, one was 50 years of age, three were in the 40s, three in the 30s. Six informants were male, and the only female informant was a professional linguist educated in USA. They all had good background in English and had experience of travel and residence abroad. It can be said that they were better educated and more conversant with speech sounds of foreign languages than ordinary Japanese speakers. The highly impressive background of the informants may be said to have significant influence on the interpretation of the results of the test. One of the informants took part only in the first test. Now, these are results of the perception test. And table one represents individual test result for syllable final plosives. Now, as you can see here, this is session one, first test, session two, second test. Now, the final plosives per occur, you can see here, and the same thing here. This H represents the informants, you see. Now, these are all represent, stand for informants. So, for instance, informant H made no mistakes for P and T, final P and T. But when you come to K, there are, you know, the errors. This man H misheard P and the K as P once. P1 means once. And in other material, the same man misheard T, the K as T this time, once.
Okay. And the person R has made the same sort of mistake here, you see. Nothing in P and T. W made one mistake in K, so he heard K as P once. And this zero symbol means he didn't write down anything, you know. The left leaves space empty, which means he didn't hear anything. Although I pronounced, for instance, pak, he didn't actually hear anything, so he didn't write down any symbol here, you see. And so on. This is a lady, the professional linguist, PhD holder from the United States. She made no mistakes at all here, right? And this man, I, is the worst case. He made mistakes not only in K, he didn't write down anything when he listened to K. And he misheard T as P once, and as zero, nothing, three times. He even made mistakes in P, you see, as in pop. He didn't hear anything here three times. And so on. Okay, I've already explained this part. Now this is perceptual errors for syllable final plosives. This is, I mean, I collapsed the earlier table one into a sort of comprehensive, you know, table. Here you can see the out of 47 hearing studies of syllable final plosives, in session one, session two, these represent session one results, and these session two. Now, if you look at the K part, again, the errors are predominant here. K was misheard as P three times, as T four times, seven times, no writing. T, similarly, you know, when they heard T, they didn't mark anything nine times. And so on. In the second session, you can see the slight improvement over the first one, you see. Only four, the silent, and four times as T, two times as P. So comparing with this, you know, first session, it shows, I mean, considerable improvement. Now let me move on to intervocalic consonant cluster. The individual perception test results of intervocalic consonant clusters, part C, is as follows, table 3, where TT in the column KT is to be interpreted, that KT was misheard as TT by the informants. So this is table 3, results of intervocalic consonant clusters, session 1, session 2, the same informants. Now, this man, H, made quite a few mistakes here, you see. He misheard TK as KK, PK as KK, PT as TT, KP as PP, KT as TT. But in the second session, these are the results of second session. Some are different, some are different, some are similar. This professional linguist, you, made only one mistake here. He heard TT as PT. Right. This is the general, you know, the comprehensive test results again. Here, yes. Out of 29 hearings in total, in the first session, 18 the mistakes were made, 18 errors. And these are the details. KT heard as TT 5 times, as PT once. And in the second session, there's, you can see, a slight improvement here too. Here, TT mistake was 5, and here only 3. Okay? PP5, PP3. TT3, TT2, etc. We can discuss some of the problems involved in this test. As can be seen in table 1 and 2, the perception error rate of K was highest. Japanese people find it most difficult to perceive the syllable final K in comparison to other the plosives. This reveals an interesting fact that the backer or point of articulation, the higher the error rate, right? K is the backest possible, but not possible, backest of the three, backest articulature, you know, point. Whereas P is the frontest possible, and followed by T. So K is from okuniaru K, followed by T, and then P, most outer P. Thus, the error rate of bilabial stop is lowest, whereas that of the velar stop with the backest articulation is highest. In the perception test, one and the same plosive sound occurs 4 times, and the total number of hearing of a particular plosive for the 7 informants is 28. That the sound K marks 50% error rate, that is 14 errors out of 28 hearings in the perception test. Decrease of error rate in the second test is noted. Notice that the error rate has decreased in the second test, as I said. For instance, T marked 10 errors in the first test, but only 6 errors in the second. Similarly, errors of K decreased to 10 errors in the second from the 14 in the first test. And the total number of errors in the first test was 28, and it decreased to 19 in the second. About the nature of perception errors, an interesting tendency is noted in the errors, as can be seen in the table 2. That is, a backer sound, a plosive with a backer articulation point, is perceived as a front sound. Thus, T is all perceived as P, because P is fronter than T, and K is misheard as either T or P. In particular, T is never perceived as K, you know, it's never perceived as backer sound. And the labial sound P is never misheard as a backer sound T or K. So you want, you like to go forward, not backward. One might characterize this phenomena as a progressive or forward perception errors. This progressive nature of perception errors can well be linked to the point made earlier that the backer the plosives, the more frequent the error rate. The cluster KT marked the highest error rate, followed by KP, PT, and TK in the intervocalic consonant clusters. The most striking feature is that the first consonant of the cluster is perceived as a second consonant, that is, KT was perceived as TT and KP as PP. You don't like the sound, the initial sound, but you stick to the second sound in the cluster like this. The consonant clusters KT and KP, which mark the highest perception error rate, both begin with K sound. Thus it can be said that K shows the highest error rate in both the syllable final position and in intervocalic clusters. As shown in table 4, the cluster KK shows only a few errors. This is self-explanatory, considering the fact that Japanese speakers tend to perceive the first consonant as the second consonant of the cluster, as I said, as each of the six intervocalic clusters occurs only once in the list. It was subject to judgment by 7 speakers, and yet KT shows as many as 6 errors in the first session. Likewise, KP also shows as many as 5 errors out of 7 hearings. As in the case of syllable final perception test, the second session, 11 errors, shows better results than the first one, 18 errors, in the intervocalic consonant perception test. Conclusion. From the perception test of the syllable final and intervocalic consonant clusters for the Japanese speakers, the following conclusion may be drawn. 1. Japanese speakers find it difficult to perceive the unexploded particle, the highest letter rate being marked by a velar stop K, followed by alveolar T and labial P. Secondly, they show a strong tendency to mark progressive perceptual errors, that is, K is perceived as the frontal sound T or P, and T as the frontal sound P. 3. They show considerable perceptual errors of intervocalic consonant clusters. In particular, clusters beginning with K, such as KT and KP, mark a very high perceptual error rate. This error rate is just as high as the syllable final K. 4. With regard to the intervocalic consonant clusters, the first consonant was identified as the second consonant. And the second consonant was hardly misheard. The fact that Japanese speakers tend to identify the first consonant as the second consonant of a cluster may be accounted for by the frequent occurrence in Japanese of homogenic consonant clusters like k, t, t, p, p, to which Japanese speakers have been well accustomed to in speaking Japanese. This phenomenon may be attributed to sogon in Japanese. Out of the 47 perceptual errors of syllable final plosive, 17 errors were related to misperception of place of articulation, but as many as 31 errors were attributed to the failure to identify or to hear silence. This could be taken as an indication that Japanese speakers' perceptual ability to judge the unexploded implosive stop is rather weak. 6. It was found that the perceptual ability varies from person to person, depending on individual linguistic and phonetic background. In the tables 1 and 3, informant U has made no errors except 1 in intervocalic consonant cluster, whereas informant I has made as many as 27 errors in all. The better result in the second session than in the first one could account for the importance of the perceptual training. The more you get training, the better you'll become. to this stresses the importance of, you know, training, phonetic training, and listening training. And this 시험, experiment or perception test itself is a good training, I think. Well, that's all. Thank you very much for your